different question. Nowadays, the wildlife photography is a common hobby, especially in IT and many people. They keep taking all the vehicles, huge kind of cameras, many things into the protected areas. They're also causing a lot of damage to the ecology and ecosystems. Many of my friends also documenting and writing their articles, how it's having negative impacts on the ecology or the habitat. What's your thoughts on that? What kind of message, advice you can give to the youngsters? Because everyone wants to become a photographer, wildlife photographer.
ನಿಮ್ಮ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದು ಸರ್ ಇಟ್ ಸಿಂಪಲ್ ಏನು ಗೊತ್ತಾ ಈಗ ಬೇಸಿಕ್ಲಿ ವಿ ಹ್ ಕಮ್ ಡೌನ್ ಟು ಎ ಸಿಚುಯೇಷನ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಇರಿವರ್ಸಬಲ್ ಸೊ ಈಗ ಇಡೀ ಈ ರೂಮು ನಾವು ಒಂದು ನಾಲ್ಕೈದು ಜನ ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಿದ್ವಿ ಟೇಬಲ್ ಕುರ್ಚಿಗಳೇ ಡಾಮಿನೇಟ್ ಆಗಿದ್ದು ಈಗ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀವಿ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಹಾರ್ಡ್ಲಿ ಗಿವಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಪೇಸ್ ಟು ಅದರ್ಸ್ ಸೊ ಅದೇ ಥರ ಇಡೀ ಕಾಡು ದೇಶ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಾಡಿತ್ತು ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಘಾಟ್ ಎಂಡ್ ಟು ಎಂಡ್ ಕನೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಇತ್ತು ವೆಸ್ಟರ್ನ್ ಘಾಟ್ ಕನ್ಯಾಕುಮಾರಿಯಿಂದ ಗುಜರಾತ್ ತನಕ ಕನೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಸೊ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಏನಾದ್ರು ಸ್ಪೀಸೀಸ್ ಕೊಲ್ಯಾಪ್ಸ್ ಆದರೆ ಇನ್ನು ಏನಾದ್ರು ಡಿಸಾಸ್ಟರ್ ಆದರೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಕಡೆಯಿಂದ ಇಟ್ ವುಡ್ ಕವರ್ ಅಪ್ ಇಟ್ ವುಡ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಟ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಯಾಚ್ ಥರ ಈಗೇನಾಗಿದೆ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಏರಿಯಾಸ್ ಆರ್ ದೇರ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ರೈಟ್ ಫ್ರ್ಯಾಗ್ಮೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಇಸ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಬಿಗ್ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಬಟ್ ದೀಸ್ ಫ್ರ್ಯಾಗ್ಮೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಈಸ್ ಡಿಸೈಡೆಡ್ ಸಮ್ಮನ್ ಸಿಟ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಡೆಲ್ಲಿ ಮ್ಯಾಪ್ ಮೇಲೆ ರೌಂಡ್ ಆಗ್ತಾನೆ ಓಕೆ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಕ್ ಯು ಆಲ್ ಗಾಡ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಗೋನ್ ಟು ಬಿ ದೇರ್ ಸೊ ದೀಸ್ ಈ ಲೋಕಲ್ ರಿಯಾಲಿಟೀಸ್ ಯಾರಿಗೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿರಲ್ಲ ಸೊ ಅದ್ರ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಜನ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅವ್ರನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ತೆಗೆದು ಆಚೆಗೆ ಹಾಕ್ತೀವಿ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ ಸೊ ಎಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಡೇ ಇಕೋ ಟೂರಿಸಮ್ ಕಾನ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದಟ್ ಹೂಎವರ್ ಇಸ್ ಪುಷ್ಡ್ ಔಟ್ ಆರ್ ಹೂಎವರ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಟು ದ ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟ್ and who are using forest for hundreds of thousands of years now they are suddenly we are depriving them of any other any sources from forest going out to them or getting any benefit from them the basic concept of ecotourism is about making money here generating money from the forest and helping the villages around anta but which is not practically happening the policy is good you encourage tourists now the lifestyle of India is changing After the IT, BT, people are seeing money. So that is why you see rich young kids, young boys and girls in the forest now. Now that go to the forest, after seeing animals for 2-3 times, they'll get bored. So they want to photograph it. So they stop at the image. But end of the day, inside the forest, only 10% of the forest area will be tourism zone. And out of that, whatever road they travel for 2 hours in the morning will cover around 1%, 10% of it. So, end of the day, you will be covering around 2 to 3% of the whole area, disturbing them for 2-3 hours. I am not saying it is good or bad, but the policy is good. Basically, by doing ecotourism, they have to somehow generate money without damaging the forest cover. And pump it out, which is not happening. But the basic principles and the ideology is correct. So whatever these fellows are talking is about the other fellow. Now it's becoming one big thing. Like in continuous, there are a lot of vehicles standing and people are photographing one stupid sleeping tiger or something. So if this fellow doesn't get the good picture and somebody else is in a prime place and if he's not living, then he'll write in the Facebook saying that. These things are getting spoiled and basically none of them are going beyond the image. Nobody is seeing the real picture. Nobody is really interested. It's all about writing on the Facebook and doing their service. It doesn't work on the hand, on the field. It is all very surface. I and you don't need to worry about it. Because I told you, that is why I told you, in the 100% of the forest, is about 10% is tourism zone. Out of that one, 10% of the area they'll be watching. And they'll come and question you, why am I not seeing tiger? Why should they be seen? And tigers have their own territory, and they don't need to come out and sleep in front of them all the time. So they'll come and say that there's nothing in Bandipur. That is all. That is all their knowledge is. That is where the story starts. Actually, the image stops and the story starts. So. if you don't see beyond it, you will not be able to, we are talking to storytellers, so it doesn't make sense at all. It's about just capturing image, going there, showing off, putting it in the Facebook. It had nothing to do with the youngsters, I think. That's why I didn't want to really expand.
Somebody who doesn't have a background in electronic media, how, and also not having the budget enough, how do we create amateur documentaries while still not infringing laws, but provide a very gripping story that would raise awareness, not for monetary gains, but just for raising an awareness, for example, marine littering, maybe. How do we raise awareness by creating such amateur documentaries? How do we go about it?
You're still studying. Then, are you from coastal area? Then why are you worried about marine littering? You worry about Rishabhavati. So, no, suddenly Rishabhavati has become a subject for me. Like, that's why I'm just going around and around it, because if I take many subjects and go on expanding on all of them, nothing will go into anybody's head. So Rishabhavati is easier now to connect. So Rishabhavati can be treated as an environmental problem. So you don't need any specialized cameras for that. And you have a lot of home videos and editing aspects. So many of your friends will be having drones, smaller drones. So you learn about how to say, tell, how to tell the story, how to use whatever you have. And then think of the budget. You don't need budget for this. If you're just thinking of the marine pollution, and going to Chennai and find out, just the research will cost you around 100,000 rupees. Here, right next to your house, if you just walk up and down and talk to people, you can find out who killed, when and how. And end of the day, you can put forward your message of whatever environmental message you want to go. You should never be a preacher. By creating love, maybe creating love for Rishabhavati, which was supposed to be a beautiful river in the middle of a city, what nonsense, what culture are we talking about? Do you even want to call yourself a cultured man? You can ask those questions, prick them, beat them up, or you can just be polite and very politely say them that this is almost irreversible, but can we just start a janandolana for that or whatever? So, whatever message, but now as you're a student, you're young and you have nothing to do with photography and storytelling, it is important. You do a lot of exercise around your house. So, I get to see a lot of documentaries on Rishabhavati next time I come. No, it can all be different point of views. It can all be 2-3 minutes films. And if I watch, I know who you are and what you are and what level you are and where I should talk, where we should communicate. Otherwise, it is very difficult for me, madam. Suddenly, if you ask wildlife questions, I don't know where to talk. Yeah. I might be just flying over nonsense. I might be just wasting everybody's time. So, if you all have 2-minute film on the Rishabhavati, I'll just love to see it. See them all, analyze, strip them apart, strip everything apart, and tell you all very, very critically where things have gone wrong. I'll not tell you if it is very good. We can all do that. That can be beautiful. Rather than, illo san, kashtagate. I can just go on talking about wildlife and documentary, but this I think is an answer for your question. Okay.
ಸುಮಾರು ಗಾಸಿಪ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಏನೇ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಎಲ್ಲ ಸೇರಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಕತೆ. ಅದೇ ನೀವು ಯಾವುದೋ ನೀವು ಮಂಗಳೂರು ಚೆನ್ನೈ ಕತೆ ನೀವು ಬರೆಯಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋದ್ರೆ ವರ್ಕ್ ಆಗಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ನೀವು ಭಾಳ
ಕೆನ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ಟ್ರೀ ಬ್ರೇಕ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ಅನದರ್ ಮೋರ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಟು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಬಿಕಾಸ್
ವೈ ಡಿಡ್ ಯು ಕಮ್ ಟು ನೋ ದಟ್?
ಹೌ ಡಿಡ್ ಯು
ವೈ ಡಿಡ್ ಯು
Right, tell me.
Again, we'll look at it as a film script. Why did you come to know that? How did you come to know that? No, Namasangha is very close to our heart, so we have tried not to give any publicity to it. We have asked all our friends in journalism not to write about it at all, honestly, because it's so close to our heart. You know, with the fame and money and exposure to any institution or any human being also. In fact, Siddaramaiah, we know Siddaramaiah very well, and he was a very nice gentleman as far as we know. But people say now it is not the same.
Changed.
With so much of experience, age, he has seen power in all levels, but still people say that he has changed a lot today. He is not the Siddaramaiah you all know.
Not Siddaramaiah.
Because one of my mentor was very close to Siddaramaiah, so from our younger days we keep meeting him, nothing. Both we are also from Mysore, so, but people say that he has dramatically changed in the last 4 or 5 years. They say the same thing about Modi, but we don't know Modi at all. We don't talk about it. But this man, we all know him. Like in Mysore, almost every journalist knows him. Everybody knows him. But he was quite a gentleman, quite a nice guy, likable character. But today they say, not the same fellow. So like that, any institution, any human being, even with lot of maturity, can change with lot of publicity and limelight. So we didn't want Nammasangha to get any publicity, nothing. Ultimately, we wanted to achieve certain things. We finished it. So it's about in 2003. There was an DFO in Bandipur, district forest officer. That time he was the head of Bandipur. So we were also working there. He came there and. He was there for a short period. She had that urgency to do something. We'll do something. So we said, whatever we have seen, we cannot solve all the problems. If we take up all the problems, we'll fail. We'll take one small, minute problem. I'll not tell you why we are taking it up, but we'll take it up. He said, let's do whatever you said. Let's say we'll start, try and see if people are interested to take gas connections, LPG gas connections. By then we had done our survey, all those things, but we were waiting for a proper person to sit in the chair because we wanted, there were a lot of associations. Very difficult to associate with any government officers and work, do any sensible job. Very, very difficult. So we wanted a very sensible officer there. We know most of them, whoever comes there, but we also know who are there, who they are, we know their background and things like that. So we were waiting for him. So one of the nice guys to come, so he was there. Because we wanted him there because even if we want to distribute gas, people have done it all over the world. Can I expand on it later? It's a huge story. It's a very, very tricky story. We only have 2 gas agencies there, that is all. In Bangalore, there must be 100 gas agencies. We have 2 gas agencies along the border of Bandipur. We are covering around 38,000 families today. And they're all using the gas.
We are addressing around
203 villages or something like that. In 203 villages, we have 38,000 families. We give gas to them. We are not giving them free. We are giving them at the basic cost. And we are still running under loss. Society is running under loss. Even today, every year, we raise around 10 lakh rupees from friends to put in new auto rickshaws. We have around 12 running auto rickshaws. We need to keep changing them every 3 years because the roads conditions are very bad. It is not a business venture at all for anyone. That is why nobody was ready to give gas to that area. And at that time, in 2003, the first connection was 7,000 rupees in Gundlupet, 7,000 rupees. And we gave the first connection at 950 rupees. And still people were not happy to receive because they were afraid of gas and so many things. They are not very completely, they are just villages. We were not even addressing tribes, the villages. But it was very difficult to convince them in the beginning. That was secondary. For that, we raised a lot of money from friends, circle. We raised around 1 crore 25 lakhs in the last 2003 to 2010. We raised around 1 crore rupees just to give the villages free stove. This was not just to avoid collecting firewood from the forest. It had a lot of other repercussions and a lot of other small stories in there. So that's why. Actually, at that time, at least 5,000 people were going into the forest every day. That means along 200 running kilometers of the forest border, the northeastern border of Bandipur, in 200 kilometers, at least 5,000 people were going in every day. And they were going up to 1 kilometer, 1.25 kilometers inside the forest. and at least 300,000 kgs of forest firewood was going out. And anybody who sees it will know that they are taking only the dry dead wood. But murder mystery, if you go, you will know how those trees have died. And why? And selective felling of species will seriously affect the ecosystem. And they're all environmental science, they'll know
selective,
what is selective.
Selective felling,
so selective felling of any species will seriously damage the ecosystem. Another thing is, we knew lot of youngsters in that area, because we had a research station there. We're doing long term wildlife filming, and lot of youngsters would come in contact with us, villagers, and they would tell me what was happening in the forest. And they would tell me whoever was going into the forest for firewood collection, part 50% of them were actually selling it, not just domestic use. And all the sellers would be young men, very young men. And they were so good, they were getting their firewood within 2 hours, they would collect and come back. They would go with bicycles and smaller vehicles and things like that in the border. They'll collect and bring it to so many other smaller towns and selling it. So they were making their money in just 2 hours, where if they had gone to any coolie, they would have to work for 8 hours. So they were getting a lot of free time at that time. They were using it for drinking and gambling and all those things. Their expenditure was also going up. The whole social thing was getting affected. Social fiber was getting affected seriously. And whatever fire department was doing, we have seen fire department doing it for hundreds of years, that they were burning, beating up people, whatever it is, and again it would start. Nothing would stop. So today the forest officers come and they say, what is that problem? Why should you give gas? There's no problem of firewood and things like that. But if you just ask anybody before 2003, they will tell you horrible stories. Like, so the same boys who were going in and getting into gambling and drinking and all sorts of bad habits, very, very young guys. They were also losing the fear of the forest. Losing the fear of the forest is one thing. As you go into the forest, you will realize within 100 meters, I don't need to tell you not to talk. If you walk alone, you will not talk. Even if I'm with you, you will not talk. You will not make any sound, because the fear will stop you from making any sound. The fear of the forest they were losing, and they were also losing the fear of the fire department. So same boys were going with the bigger poachers. Poachers who would come for ivory or for teakwood and rosewood, they would go with them. Those poachers, those serious poachers, would be one in 20 villages. They were hardcore people, they were in the police records and this thing. Whereas these boys, this is smaller offense, like firewood collection. But they were getting into that fabric, they were getting into that vicious circle. So we thought, if we cut off the market itself, what would happen? That was not easy, but 15 years later, we have 38,000 connections and nobody is going into the forest. And it was also depriving the wild animals about 1.5 kilometer length from the borders. In the morning, they were deprived of using it. Continuously, people. So it will actually amount to, that 1.5 kilometer will amount to, multiplied by around 210 kilometers, it will amount to around 300 square kilometers, which is one third of Bandipur. So this was a big thing, and so we wanted the officer, because at that time it was very difficult to get the gas agency. But there was one provision where we could get the gas agency in the name of the national park itself. So we got the two gas agencies, the national park, and Namma Sangha, as an agreement with the national park, we run the show. We pump in the money, we run the show. We take all the money, that's it. We are not still, whatever, sometime we'll make some money, we'll just spend it on the education around the village. So none of us, we have around 17, 18 members, and none of us are entitled for any money, for anything. For phone, travel, water. We have very serious professional in that. We have chartered accountant who works free for me. If it's a surprise, la. Chartered accountant who works free for us, a lawyer who works free for us. There are many professionals who work free to Namma Sangha. So only the boys who work there, the localites, we have around 26 plus 26 permanent plus another 14, 15 temporary, around 40, 45 boys get paid. That is the surficial Dhammasanga story. Otherwise, we faced hundreds of hurdles. You cannot imagine why would a positive story will have so many hurdles. Politicians, officers, everybody wanted to bloody stop it. Then after 10 years, we realized one of the politicians, we asked him to inquire with all our MLAs, MPs, everybody. MP was good as MLAs, two MLAs were coming. We wanted another MLA here. We asked him to somehow find out why they are troubling us so much. Because we had to zero down on what is the trouble, why is it? Because the trouble would be coming in different direction. Our Namasanga gas agencies were raided almost every other month. And those are the only two gas agents which are running without selling the gas in the black market. If you don't sell the gas in the black market, it's very difficult to run the agency. So all the, until the Aadhaar was linked, all the gas agencies, at least 30% of them, not on record, because I don't have, but it is true that 30% of them were being sold in the black market, being sold to commercial organizations, hotels, especially hotels. Because this is highly subsidized, what we are using at home is highly subsidized only for domestic use. That was being sold in the black market, that is where people are making a lot of money. And these two agencies were not selling and it was being raided every other month. So we were getting confused what is happening, and it was happening from all directions. Then we zeroed down on the politicians, some of the politicians. So we found out through another politician what is this problem. He just wanted assurance that Kurpakar is not standing for election in that area. So then we realized, oh yeah, this is the thing, and we said, we again through the same MLA, we assured him that we'll never enter politics in that. This is all too horrible. It's impossible. When you take a different path, the story will be entirely different. That is why when you tell a story, if you go a little more in depth, the stories will always have two sides. So you need to be, as a journalist, should be able to see all the sides. Whatever is a martyr for Pakistan is a terrorist for us. Whatever was a martyr today for us was a terrorist one day for British. Whoever is a martyr for us is a killer for them, so like that. So all have a different stories, different. So don't go with a prejudice. Maybe when you're doing a documentary, we'll have tea.
Yeah, we'll have tea. Come 5 minutes.
But you're gonna have what tea? Okay. I think we should converse more than me talking all the time.